He visited Corinth on his missionary journeys. After he had been there, he sent two letters back to them, and possibly more, to describe the faith to them in more detail so that they would understand in a more fulsome way how to live out their faith in a really cosmopolitan community. Many of us don't understand the ancient world. We cannot imagine in our heads what Corinth would have been like. Do you understand the Roman Empire extended in either direction beyond Corinth? Corinth was almost in the middle, even more than Rome was. It was a place where ships passed from the left and the right. It was a crazy place, lots of things happening, and it is into this community that Paul wants to help them understand their faith so that they can live it out at the highest level. In chapter 15, he writes these words, "My friends, I want you to remember the message that I preached and that you believed and trusted. You will be saved by this message if you hold firmly to it. But if you don't, your faith was all for nothing." In other versions, it says, "in vain." I told you the most important part of the message, exactly as it was told to me. That part is, Christ died for our sins, as the scriptures say. He was buried, and 3 days later, he was raised to life, as the scriptures say. Christ appeared to Peter, and then to the 12, and after this, he appeared to more than 500 other followers. Most of them are still alive, but some have died. He also appeared to James, and then to all of the apostles. Finally, he appeared to me, even though I am like someone who was born at the wrong time. I am the least important of all the apostles. In fact, I cause so much trouble for God's church that I don't even deserve to be called an apostle. But God was kind. He made me what I am. And his wonderful kindness wasn't wasted. I worked much harder than any of the other apostles, although it was really God's kindness at work and not me. But it doesn't matter. If I preached or if they preached, all of you believed the message just the same. The word of the Lord. Let us pray together. As we open up the scriptures this day, we ask you, O God, to speak to us from it. Help us open our minds to the presence of your Holy Spirit in the Word, that we see beyond the flat print on the page to the powerful Spirit at work in what you have shared with us and how you invite us to grow and be fully your presence in this world. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the face of all that has gone on this past week, what do we as the church, as the people of God, have to say? Whether it be the purported threat of violence at the Minnising Valley High School that kept hundreds of students home on Friday, the untimely death of a Minnising guidance counselor, the diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia for Haley Decker, or all the other things that we shared in the many prayers that we prayed today, what do we say? We say, resurrection matters. The Apostle Paul puts it this way, "I told you the most important part of the message, exactly as it was told to me. That part is, Christ died for our sins, as the scriptures say, and he was buried, and 3 days later, he was raised to life, as the scriptures say." Paul knew it was true. He knew others who had seen the risen Christ, and he himself had encountered the risen Jesus on the road to Damascus. For him, there was no doubt. Jesus was alive, and it changed everything. All that followed from that was resurrection power. Understanding resurrection is essential. If we are to become what God intends for us to be, our calling as apostles, just like Paul, the ones sent into the world, is based on our understanding of resurrection power. We are not powerless. We are empowered to be God's presence. We are the ones going into the world with amazing good news. We were in the past disciples on the way into faith. We were naive and green and unprepared. We came trying to learn about faith and how to be faithful. But now we have been empowered by the Spirit, empowered by resurrection, and we are apostles on the way out of the building into the worlds in which we live, where we play, where we work, prepared to bring hope and good news and the warm embrace of the people of God. But so our minds and our hearts are clear. We need to get this straight. Yesterday I had the opportunity to do a funeral. I don't know if some of you realize this, but last year I did 23 funerals. Part of the reason I think the funeral directors call me is because I'm dignified. They also have something to do with the fact that I'm short, and I don't mean short this way, but maybe short in length of service. I've taken it as a real calling, because I think anytime I go to a funeral service, I'm the one there to talk about the resurrection. Do you understand? There's other people who are there to talk about the person who has passed. And that's really important stuff. And don't get me wrong. I tell them, yesterday I didn't happen to know, the man's name was Donald Dodd. I didn't know him. I said that up front. You know, I'm not here to tell you something about him because I really don't know much. But what I do say is I think it's terribly important that those that do know him, that you go home after this is all done and you sit down, take out a piece of paper or get out your phone or your iPad or whatever, and that you type up or write up a story about this person that only you might have known. Something about them that was crazy or funny or highly inappropriate, that always gets a big laugh. As people think about the stories that they do not want the minister to know or share. But they, you know, write them down because they're really important. You know, when my family gets together at Christmas time and at summertime, we often get talking and we remember these stories about, for example, my mother, my father too, but my mother was a real piece of work. I think I told you this before, she decided to take basket weaving, right? So she goes to the local school, that's back when school district offered all these extra classes. She took basket weaving. She comes home, she's going to weave a basket. Well, the thing with basket weaving is you got to keep the basket, the reeds and stuff, you got to keep them wet. So you got to put them down in a bucket. Well, she had a bad back. So she's in this chair, she's leaned over this basket. She wants to make this basket so bad, but her back is killing her. She looked out in the backyard, and she saw that swimming pool. The next thing you know, she's in the swimming pool making the basket. That's my mother. She was crazy. And my father was worse. But those are the stories that we share when we get together about these people that we love. But you know what's even more important? We know this is not the last time we're going to see them. Those two nutcases, we're going to see again. And not only are we going to see them, but we're not going to see them broken, we're going to see them whole. That's the resurrection. That's the way we're to be looking at the world. Not to see its brokenness. Certainly in the midst of its brokenness, we're supposed to do something. We're supposed to be the people of God's presence. We're to bring care and love and all those things. But we need to understand that it is that death is not in charge because of this good news. Our minds and our hearts need to be clear. Death is not the end. It is just the beginning. Life is only a prelude to a grand symphony that God has crafted for us to play in and sing in as part of his new heaven and new earth for the rest of eternity. If Eden remained, think about that. Eden finally right before the fall, before the pain and suffering, before the eternal and infernal separation that has made us so much less than what God intended. Think about this. Beyond this life, there is an eternity where we will be present with God every day. And our hearts will burst with joy. What is happening now is just the life of a follower. It's a temporary assignment. We are servants. We get to work for the Master as God prepares for us an eternity where we will live in his presence. All of this joy and sorrow is shaping you and I for that day when we will see him face to face with all of our blemishes, all our mistakes, all our disobedience, and even all our failures washed away in God's love. Here and now we deal with the painful losses and small successes of life. People we care about get sick, confused, lost, and have to deal with daunting difficulties. We are to love them as best we can in wholeness, knowing full well that any final healing will only come when they are in God's presence. We can't hold them. We can only walk with them and introduce them to the Lord of life, who rose victorious over death and in whom they can entrust their existence. We can introduce them to the resurrection and its power, where death never has the final say because there is life beyond death. We can hold the hands of those who grieve. We can and should rail against the powers that champion death, who let suffering continue unabated, who choose themselves and their comfort over the most basic needs of others whom God loves. It's easy to get discouraged, which is why we are invited to gather as fellowship often and to invoke God's presence among us, just as we were promised when two or three of us gathering, God would be in our midst. We need each other. We need to cling to each other so that as the toll of giving this challenging life its due, we can share with each other what God offers as he brings his grace to bear in each of us. Will illness take some of us? Yeah. Will death come untimely? Yeah. Will some of us struggle and feel like failure is our constant companion? Yeah. But resurrection power continues in us too. Look around at these strange people in these pews. We are the people of resurrection power. And when we apply it, God does miracles of love and grace. So don't lose heart. Instead, look to the testimony of others like Paul. The Holy Spirit is present in the house. Open your hearts to the Lord and let the healing rains pour down so that we can again work in the fields of the Lord to his glory and honor. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, that you have given us a taste of Eden, of that future beyond this life. We thank you that we can be confident because he who was dead is risen, and it makes all the difference in the world. May we cling to that hope and be prepared to serve to the best of our ability, knowing that you have empowered us to live lives of grace. This we ask through Jesus Christ. Amen.